Good morning. I'm Harrison Spencer. I congratulate the department on 50 years of excellence, and it's also a great pleasure to be here at this superb university, and I really like the city of Montreal a lot. We did our leadership retreat here 3 years ago, and it was just a stunningly successful event, so again, it's great to come back. To follow up on what my colleague just said, and reflecting on accreditation, in the United States and some places in Canada, Mexico, the Council on Education and Public Health accredits schools and programs. It's an onerous thing for all of us, and it's certainly got a lot of flaws, but it does two things. It provides a guaranteed platform that you have to have in order to be a school of public health. And the second is it's a very powerful tool for institutions thinking about becoming schools of public health, because they can, if they plan to seek accreditation by CEEF, they can insist and negotiate to have those things achieved. In reflecting on the role of schools of public health in the 21st century, to me, it's all about the value proposition. In other words, the roles that schools do are of great value to society. The problem is society doesn't really understand the value, I think, of what schools and academic institutions do in terms of the students that come out of there with a framework in population health, the kinds of research in terms of the long view of outcomes research, of prevention science, of implementation science, the focus on equity, social justice, health disparities, where the population is not just the aggregate of individuals, but the distribution of the problems, and the ability to put these things together and focus on true population health. The problem is, in virtually every country, no matter whether you're single payer or not, I think, having been in the UK and know it well, there's an overwhelming preponderance of focus on individuals and disease. And it's very good to get the power structure and a political structure off the mark to really focus on true population health and the value of a much broader on health rather than just disease. And I think that's the fundamental thing that all institutions face wherever you are. I'm asked all the time, go to universities and talk about why should we develop a school of public health. Well, number one is schools of public health are the most entrepreneurial in the university. They're always coming forward because of their mission, come forward with different and creative ideas. Secondly, there's lots of demand. Students, as you heard over and over, plenty of students want to do this. They're having increasingly younger generation says, we want to serve. We're interested in things that help society. We're interested in public health. We're interested in global health. Research, at least in the United States, faculty in schools of public health are the highest FTE per dollar value from NIH, and really that counts a lot in universities. Schools of public health leverage across the university. They have to partner because they don't have everything they need in order to carry out their mission. So they have to link up with all those other schools, and particularly medicine, but many others across the university. They have to partner with communities. They have to focus on disparities. They have to create partnerships across, and they have to be interprofessional and in some ways intra-professional. Just to focus on a few things, because really lots of commonality through all the talks. One of the things I think public health does, schools of public health, is focus on education in a very creative way. So in the United States, as I'm going to university after you, sitting with deans of health science schools and talking, listening to faculty, there's a lot of unease across health professionals in the United States about the education that they're receiving and its relevance for, and also problems with the health system. In 2010, many of you saw a report called the Lancet Commission report on health professionals in the new century. It was full of public health people. It was chaired by Julio Frank, the dean at Harvard, and Lincoln Chin, the China Medical Board. And basically it said, what we really need to think about is look at the system and see what the system needs and back it up to who's going to do that, and then back that up to the education of those people that are going to do it. What we do now is decide what those people are going to, we're going to educate them, and then what we're going to do is layer them across the system. And by the way, we operate in silos, and we expect them to do teamwork, but we never teach them about teamwork. The second thing, so education, I think, is a huge role and can really stimulate. We've just gone through a process called Framing the Future. It's on our website, and multiple town halls and discussions and panels. And basically, we took an empty room approach and said, if we're designing 100 years after Welsh Rose, somebody showed the Welsh Rose report in 1915, what would our curriculum look like? And it's now going to be completely different going forward. I think all health professionals need to do this, but public health really is the one that will often take the lead in doing this. The previous colleague mentioned governmental public health. The schools of public health have a very important role, I think, in supporting the governmental public health wherever, whichever country they're in, training it and so forth. And we actually, Institute of Medicine that he was talking about actually has governmental public health in the middle, and then other sectors around it, which include care delivery as one sector, but also many others like education and communication and on and on. And thinking about the health of populations in a multi-sectoral approach is really, I think, what public health is about. And the last thing, so we can really get to the panel, because I think that would be, I'd like to hear the questions, is about population health. So there are 50, Susan Dentzer, the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, had found 52 or 53 definitions of population health. And it's, at least in the United States, it's all over the place. But a lot of people are talking about population health as the population under the financial system, so that it's our population, but we're not really concerned how well they're doing in terms of their outcomes, but we're focusing on them as a population that we serve and that we're paid to serve. Public health, population health is really is part of public health. It's a broad understanding of systems thinking. And the most important thing about what schools of public health do in thinking about this is population health is not just the aggregate of individuals and their outcomes. It's also the distribution of the outcomes within the population. So that means even if you have a good average outcomes, you're going to find pockets everywhere where populations are not having optimal outcomes. And that's what public health is. It brings the systems approach and the analytic tools. I think it's more in the British sense, and probably the Canadian sense too, which is the GP in the UK really was responsible for the health of the population ascribed to the under the practice. Historically, in relating to medicine, public health provided numerous competencies to physicians: capacity to understand qualitative analysis, clinical epidemiology. In practical terms, people operating in clinical spaces with some level of competency in epidemiology, and it certainly informs clinical research. Outcomes research is part of public health, not just disease outcomes, but health level plus distribution within the population. Sophisticated public health understands aggregation plus distribution within the population. That's the point about this closeness with medicine, but on the other hand, it's also about the role of helping medicine and working politically in any other way to help medicine understand that the focus only on individuals' disease is not really what's needed in the 21st century. There's something called the triple aim, Don Berwick in the United States. It's cost, outcomes, and population health. And that's really the kind of health system. And the dean of medicine here earlier mentioned, I mean, all countries have this problem with chronic disease. And that's what's driving the morbidity, that's what's driving the cost. And that's not going to be solved one-on-one by focus on individuals and disease. It's going to require a population health approach. For example, in the United States, 65% of Medicare people have more than one chronic disease. Medicare beneficiaries, these are people over 65. And 95% of the cost of Medicare are going toward those. So we all face this same problem. So there's really enormous value to creating schools of public health. It's value to the university, it's value to society, and I'm hoping that the weight will continue to tilt, as my colleagues have all said, toward increasingly society realizing the value of these institutions. Thank you so much.